We are delighted to welcome Professor Mernissi here. Thank you very much for being here.
I am very moved, of course. But I will talk about something else so as not to stop my emotions. I'll talk about my coat. This coat creates so much trouble for me because, of course, in Morocco, I don't use much of it. So I only use it when I am going to the West. Like now, everyone wants me to take it. But I am so worried. If I take it, I'll catch cold. But I think I am going to try something. I'll put it here, and if I get cold, I can get it. I will try not to talk about Eqbal at the beginning, because I want first that people understand what's going on in the Arab world. I can't speak for Muslim world because I haven't been traveling much to the like Asia, Asian Islam, like Pakistan since 87 and so on. So I will only be talking for Arab world, and even Arab world, I'll be talking for North Africa, really. So I will try to tell you where I am coming from, and then I'll talk about Eqbal. And it makes a lot of sense about who he is. Because if I tell you, in fact, what he is, what he was a Sufi, but maybe he didn't even know it, neither did I. So it's only now, at my age, that I discovered that a lot of stuff I am doing, like this dialogue, and my specialty, I am working all my life about the frontier, the boundary. Why do we need boundaries? I never could understood it. And this desire to cross boundaries, be it sex, you know, sexual boundaries or cultural boundaries, understanding the other as a stranger, was always with me. But what I didn't know, because I thought I was modern and different from my grandmother, was that I was a Sufi. Because Sufism was just part of the tradition right there. And I wanted to be something modern. Probably just like Eqbal, but anyway, so that you understand this coming back of the Sufi tradition of wanting to dialogue with a stranger, of this wonderful thing to be talking to stranger as the best source of information, this is Sufism. I only discovered it later. But I will start, I will try to follow the diagram I have done to look scientific. Now, when Norman Holland called me, I told him the title would be The Emperor's New Frontier. Only if civility has no borders will terrorism vanish. That was the title I sent him. And it was the title of the only article I wrote after the September 11th as an introduction to the paperback of Islam and Democracy, which was the book I wrote after the Gulf War trauma. What I discovered, I am here since the 1st of March. What Americans don't know is that the terror, the September attack didn't terrorize Americans only. It terrorized the whole world. Terrorized the whole world. We were everyone was so scared by that, because whoever did it, if he hit that tower, he could hit Casablanca or Lahore. So I couldn't write, and I couldn't put myself in the work. But one thing started me going. I don't have children of my own, but because of that, I am very close to the new generation and involved in a lot of civil society building, which are trying to help young people get confidence in their talents. This project is called Civic, Synergy Civic, Civic Synergy. And therefore, I decide, no, I shouldn't be so disempowered by this terror. I have to work on helping young people. They have to think of me as the old generation is capable of doing something. And I decided, what is this thing? And I said, it's dialogue. Okay, it's dialogue building, that's my job. And then just at the beginning, I couldn't do my work as a university researcher who is paid salary, and I had to do these writing workshops for NGOs and human rights activists. I couldn't do it. But then I just said, okay, Mafi, you take the money for the government, you stand up and do your job. And I started, and you have no idea. I know about that the best way I know I am depressed is when I think I am nothing. That's it. So I just decided, okay, you are nothing, but still do something. And I just started this writing workshops and organizing this caravan, which is going to take place in April 12, 13, 14 in Marrakesh, where these books we produce for human rights, we present them in rural area, because no writer think about rural area to present the books, because the rural area don't have money. Alors, the dialogue. Now, when I received the fax from, oh, by the way, how much time do I have? No, but I want at least half an hour discussion. So please stop me doing this when I have only 20 minutes left. Okay? I answered, no, there came a fax telling me they didn't like the title, they want to change it. So I tell them, okay, give me another alternative. So they kept the Emperor's New Frontier, but they changed. They told me it would be Terrorism and the Border of Civil Society. That's the what they gave me, because they thought it was better English. Alors, I accepted it and decided I'll work with it. But then, today, feeling stronger with 1 week knowledge of this new America, I decided my title is this one. Alors, the Emperor's New Frontier, only an army of dialogue masters can win the war against terrorism. That's clear. Now, I go, what is terrorist? What is a terrorist? Terrorist is a person who cannot dialogue. He hates himself. He can only kill. Well, someone who kills, he doesn't love himself. To love yourself, to be able to dialogue, you have to love yourself enough. You have to have enough self-confidence in yourself to enjoy discovering the other. The other, be it the other sex or the other culture. In my new book, Scheherazade Goes West, I talk about this I do believe that everywhere sexes do not dialogue well. Men and women do not talk to each other well. We spend our times fighting each other. Of course, we like each other, but the fights are. So I decided that the other sex is the stranger, the other culture, the boundary you have to cross. He is or she is different. And any nation who can solve and make men and women dialogue or creates a culture where men and women can dialogue better, that society will also develop the capacity to dialogue with the other culture. They go together. That's my theory. Alors, I will go now to the dialogue. How you can, first of all, I don't think any society have really put serious thinking into developing a culture of dialogue where you are taught from school how to dialogue. You know how I was brought up? Escoute ou sma. Shut up and listen. That's what I was told in Quranic school. On differently when I grow up, the police in the street told me, you shut up and listen. Now there is this Al-Kindi. He is Abu Yaqub Al-Kindi. He is a philosopher and a mathematician of 9th century. He wrote, he tried to define, as I don't know if it's as a philosopher or as an astrologer, philosopher, mathematician, astrologer. I don't know why he needed to define what humanity is. So, humanity, what distinguishes a human being from animal? Al-insaniyatu, humanity, hiya al-hayat wal-nutq wal-maut. I should start by the animality, not animal. What is an animal? The essence of animality. It's life and death. Al-hayat wal-maut. And the human being is life, capacity to express oneself, and death. So that's what distinguishes us. Capacity to distinguish, to express oneself. Well, I could say that the control of information have robbed many of us from their humanity. And mostly, not only, I could say propaganda, you know, we are all objects of propaganda. That's, it didn't leave us the capacity to express ourselves. Now, I believe that something fantastic is happening in the Muslim world, or as I said, in the Arab world, is the information technology. The internet and the satellite TV are transforming the Muslim world, the Arab world, completely. Why? Because the information technology is reviving the art of jadal. Jadal is to communicate, to convince the other who has different opinion, but you have to talk. It's a war of words. In fact, when I looked at dictionary, it means la lutte. You know the Chinese big man? What do they do? La lutte. What is it called? Wrestling. Yes. Wrestling with words. And this art, I'll read about this jadal. the satellite TV and the internet are bringing it back. My God, where did I put the thing? Jadal. In the Quran, there is many times, the word Jadal comes many times. It appears 29 verses, explains Majid Turki, the scholar, he is Tunisian, who in 1978 reissued in Paris the Arabic original of Kitab al-Minhaj fi Tartib al-Hijaj, the book of the techniques of chaining arguments. This book has been condemned by Arab despots and their in-house imams since its initial publication in the 11th century. Al-Baji, its author, reminded his readers that the best strategy for a Muslim to gain power over his enemies is to practice the technique indicated in verse 1 to 5 of Surah 16, An-Nahl, the bee, which says, reason with them, jadilhum, in the most courteous manner, wa jadilhum billati hiya ahsan. If you want to get power, you do jidal, not jihad. The genius of Al Jazeera, this famous television, I think you have heard about it, which stole the show from CNN. The genius of this Al Jazeera TV team, formed by Arab men and women media professionals who gained their experience working in London-based Arab section of the BBC. You know, they were exiles from this Arab despotic, but now they are getting their revenge, was to reintroduce this jadal, the art of polemics and controversy, as the basic concept of their most watched programs. They have recruited millions of Arab viewers. I heard 40 million. That's a lot. For this channel, since it started broadcasting in 1996, the two most popular programs, Al-Ra'i Al-Akhar, the other opinion, and Al-Ittijah Al-Mu'akis, the opposite direction, bring together groups with divergent opinions and encourage them to defend their positions by using jadal, logical arguments which allow the final consumer of the show, the sovereign Arab viewer, to draw their own conclusions. For example, they brought the Taliban when they destroyed the Bamiyan statues. So we had the Taliban, and to what we are discovering through this Al Jazeera is a lot of leaders of Muslim, non-Arab Muslim countries speak Arabic. So we had the Taliban guy speaking in Arabic to us, explaining why he destroyed the... But in front of him, there was the Egyptian, one Egyptian imam facing him. So the Taliban said that he destroyed it because it was against Islam. It wasn't a Muslim. So the Egyptian told him, my God, Islam invaded Egypt, one of the first countries, and it didn't destroy the Egyptian pharaonic heritage, because it considered it part of human history. And so the other one got so entangled in discrediting this Egyptian that we understood immediately that that guy did anything about the Quran and surely nothing about the Islamic religion or attitude towards. He was just a killer. That's what he was, a destroyer. The Jadal, in his this book of Baji, on the assumption, the Jadal operates on the assumption that the human brain operates rationally, and that once you convince someone by leading him via a strategically ordered cascade of arguments to adopt your own opinion, you have won him over. This science, this is now Baji speaking, this science, he explains, is the best of all sciences and the most important because it is the way to understand and distinguish between what is true, al-haq, and what is impossible, muhal. Where jadal is used, force is unnecessary. The author repeats citing an impressive number of Quranic verses and hadiths, the Prophet saying to make his point. The art of the jadal gave Muslims a rich genre of livre, also called nazar, contemplation, and khilafiyat, dissenting opinions. Throughout the most brilliant centuries of Islamic civilization, which included such thinkers as Ghazali, 12th century, Ibn al-Qassar, 11th, and Ibn al-Sa'ati, 13th century. Another genre often linked to jadal literature is the adab of bahth, or how-to manuals of polite conversation, which go into the details of teaching body language and theatrical tricks to enhance one's communication skills as a power base. Okay, now what this TV satellite is doing is unearthing and giving this thing which was suppressed, this jadal, is coming out in this satellite TV, giving, empowering the people who were deprived of the right to express their opinion. Now, how am I going doing on time? Combien? Huh? Oh, good. Alors, I want to present so that you realize when I am saying about this revolution that I'm not talking about elite. So maybe I will talk about, and this jadal links to another thing which is in Islam very strong, the stranger as an asset. You see, to understand that, you have to understand that the Arabs were traders. They had nothing but to trade. I mean, to talk and to take goods from one place to the next. So their wealth was built on talking to each other, because Mecca is between Africa, Asia, and Europe, and that was their thing. So the stranger seemed bad. You know, all our 1001 night is full of this desire of this foreigner as someone who is going to bring you, to give you the capacity to discover yourself. And Safar, when I started looking, so for the Sufi, you can develop yourself if you listen to strangers. So the trip is an important part of, you don't have to go to university. You have to travel, my dear. And as this Koshairi, he says, you can travel by distance, your body in the distance, but that's not travel. You have to travel in your mind. And just about this Koshairi, when I was reading him, it was before writing this book. So I said, because he says there is two kinds of travels. The travel of the stupid person who is just, she goes with the bag from one place to another, and the clever one who listens and hears and learns from the difference. So I was sure I was part of the second category, that I was going to make it and learn, because this book started when my book, Dreams of Trespass, when it came out, the first sentence is, I was born in Harem, in Fez, in 1940. So I had, the book was translated, it's my first fiction. It was translated in 26 languages. And I had to do 10 cities for promotion, Western. And I had to see 100 journalists. So the moment they start, the harem, you are born in a harem, and they smile. And I was very shocked. How could they smile? The harem is not funny. It's not funny at all, actually. It's a space where women are oppressed. So I was saying, I hated the first ones. And then I said to myself, my God, aren't you saying that you are good learning Sufism and this stuff, and you hate them because they don't understand, they don't interpret the same word the way you do? So, of course, I am a Sufi just training myself, because in Morocco, it's a big boom now. It always was. But when I wanted to, they told me there is not 10 many ways to learn about Sufism. You just get a master. And I told them, never. And they told me, you never be a Sufi. But I thought I can just train myself, but... So I said to myself, I have to understand what the Westerners means by the word harem. So I discovered they have their harem, and we have ours, and they have nothing to do together. Theirs is the paintings, it's the film of Hollywood, you know, Alibaba and all that. And mine is also fantasy in paintings, and also in 1001 Nights, but also the real stones of the palaces. In Morocco, there is a lot of old harems, which are now these luxury hotels. So I decided I am going to learn, and for 4 years, I spent a lot of money because I don't know anything about painting, neither in the Arab world nor in the miniature. And I started gathering this thing and bugging many of my university colleagues who knew anything about it, until they started running away from me when they see me in the university corridor. And then I published the book. I went to show it in Germany. They invited me to teach a course, Anne-Marie Schimmel, Madame Anne-Marie Schimmel Lectureship, and who is a Sufi, and I went there, and I was presenting the book, and the young German boys were screaming, you didn't understand anything about Western men, because I'm saying the Western man loves stupid women, while the Muslim man likes intelligent women, like Shahrazad. So they told me, you understood nothing. They were screaming and trying to convince me. And now there is a review on Amazon.com, because now in Morocco, I know everything by looking at the internet. So in Amazon.com, this woman said, she thinks she understands the West. She knows nothing about the West. She never been there, and so on. What I am saying is, now here I am. I wasted so much money that even the advance I got on art books, that even the advance is nothing compared to the money I wasted to do this book. And my findings are destroyed. So, of course I want to defend them. My God, I invested in this false image of the West. So, okay. Now I am faced with this. A lot of, I talked on radio in The Connection in Boston. The man was telling me, we like intelligent women. I mean, what is this? So, bien, what I'm saying is, it's not easy to dialogue. My God, you lose a lot of money into dialogue. But you see, I have the choice to stick to my findings, and I am okay maybe for 1 year, or to say, okay, I was wrong. What's happening in the West, maybe they have changed. So you can stereotype. Stereotype is a bad investment. You have to change your mind. Okay, alors, it's not, what I'm saying is, it's not naturel to dialogue or to be open-minded, because it is costly. Okay? So, très bien. I have a hard time dealing with this, but I think that's it. So, I have to say what I found is wrong. It's difficult, I cannot say it yet, but maybe in 1 year. I'll go now to, so this learning from strangers, I did learn, I thought, but of course what I learned was wrong, but that's another story. But still, learning from strangers is what Sufism is about. And I have two things to do. I want to talk about Iqbal, because he really did some strange things to me, that man. And also about this Bannour, who is your average young Arab man lost in the desert in a very tiny village, who was selling on the store, selling goods. You know, he sells, he makes art, this art, he sells in the souk, sitting down in the souk. My encounter with him and how he become now, he is the hero of my next book on cyber Islam, because the internet and the satellite TV transformed his life. And I have a letter he wrote to me about how, and I would read it. But I want to talk now about Iqbal. Iqbal, I met him in the 70s, when I went back after my PhD at Brandeis. I went back and I was recruited at the University Mohammed V as a teacher, sociology teacher. And at that time, I was really very proud of what I have learned, and I was told that PhD is better than the French diploma, and better, of course, than the Moroccan. So I was very big-headed. And my dissertation was published, Beyond the Veil, in 75. And I was very proud of that. And just, you know, you cannot imagine how arrogant, you know, you can imagine how arrogant you are when you are that age. So I was into this. By the way, in the university, in Muslim universities, you see, in Islam, women are considered like Shahrazad. A woman is necessarily super clever. That's for sure. Like Shahrazad, she has a kind of intelligence which can destabilize anyone who has power. I will not talk about Shahrazad, but there is plenty of stuff on that. Alors, at the the field of whatever is culture in the Arab world, there is no fights with women and men. You compete, because culture is a woman's field. It's only politics, which is supposed to be all male. Don't go near there, but culture you go. So at the university, we're already in 1970s, something like 25% were women tenured. Harvard was having fighting for 2% then. Alors, in the discussion of the department meeting, I thought and I liked interviewing. And in Brandeis, I became very good at it. They were teaching something called in-depth interview, and I became very, very good at that. So in the table where we were, something like 40 teachers discussing, they said, what each one is going to teach. So I was the first, and I said, I want to teach les méthodes de recherche. What is research method. And they all laughed, because it's not Arab to be this pushy. So, and they told me, why are you fit better than us, and how do you know? So I told him, because I am the best, you know, the American stuff I learned. So that day, the discussion was small. I think they just thought it was too much. I was just so strange there. So I found it strange how it ended up. And they said, OK, you do what you want. You can try a research method, but you do it with others, and we'll see if you are the best. So I was walking in the Ende Gsus, Mohammed Gsus, the friend of Iqbal, and he was the one who is going to introduce me to. So he came to me and told me, you know, Fateema, I have a PhD like you from America, but I just want to tell you something. I don't know you. Maybe you don't want to hear, but I just wanted to tell you something. You know about that thing you said about I am the best? Do you know something about the Sufi? And I told him, well, I don't know what you are driving at. Just say it so we could talk. So he told me the Rumi. He told me that Rumi said, the true teacher knocks down the idol that the student makes of him. He didn't add much and run, you know, just like the Sufi do. Now, I was saying this man is really strange. I mean, this thing is very, there must be something wrong with me. Alors, and I started going to, at the university we had the police watching us, the telephone on police ground, just like in Latin America. And then I went to Gsus and I told him, you know, you told me that thing. You cannot just let me like this. You have to give me more and help me. So he told me, yes, you can come. I give couscous on, I don't remember if it was Saturday or something. And you can just come. And then I started going to that couscous at midday, and although I was, a lot of people will come. You don't have to show who you are. Students, the grocer from Moroccan, who maybe brings the bread and then stays because it's interesting what's being said there, and so on. So I was discovering something else that is the tradition of Islam, and that is the Sufi tradition, that the teacher is not necessarily in this status thing. He can be just standing or sitting in a living room and talking, and that's how these kids here, I see Nadia in front of me, and we're growing up in this. So that's how I met Iqbal. So Iqbal, I heard that tried to kidnap Monsieur Kissinger, that he was Pakistani, and he tried to kidnap Kissinger, and he was anti-war activist. So of course, it was a huge room to come to see Iqbal. And then he wasn't talking much. You know, he was just listening and so on. And he was, I don't know what I said about architecture. Arab architect, that it was beautiful, did he see it? And he told me, yes. I went to Fez, yes, and I went to Marrakesh, which is the two bigger cities with good architecture. And he told me, what about you? Did you go to Lahore and to New Delhi? And I told him, well, I didn't. And he told me, well, you'll be surprised how small is the architecture in the Arab countries compared to that. Well, and so I was telling, so he told me, well, why didn't you read? So I told him, how can I know about this Asian Islam? He told me everything about it is gigantic. And the Arab Islam is minus. So I was, and I told him, what can I read? Because I always, of course, need manuals to make myself clever. And he told me, well, read Ibn Battuta. And in fact, it was that encounter with him that opened me to Asian Islam. And I read Ibn Battuta, and this book, in fact, is full of Asian Islam. And it's just an incredible thing that I am here talking about Iqbal. I never realized that he started all this. Now, Iqbal was himself, you know, this way to talk slowly and to have silence so that the others could come in. It's Sufi technique. Maybe he didn't know it. I don't know. Gassous, I discovered, was very knowledgeable about the technique. And we both come from this tradition of Sufi, but I will, here is what, when he told me to read about the Ibn Battuta and Asian Islam. Ibn Battuta, he is the Marco Polo of Islam. He was born in Tangier, and he started going from Tangier all the way to Mecca, Central Asia, to China. And he wrote his journal. So the spectacular visibility, one of the big things I discovered reading Ibn Khaldun, and when I went to Pakistan in 87, was the incredible power of women in the public sphere. At that time, 87, it was, what's his name, the general who was ruling? Ziaul Haq. He was ruling, but at the same time, there was these women were not, the political parties were paralyzed. But the women were doing an incredible thing in civil society, and that's where I learned how to do the thing in the garage or in the living room. You don't need to have a big space. And now, the spectacular visibility of women in outdoor ceremonies are among the Muslim Turks and Mongols from Central Asia has always baffled Arab travelers who reveal themselves in their descriptions of this phenomena to be the most conservative of all Muslims on the seclusion and veiling of women. I discovered, really, after this encounter with Iqbal and my interest in the, you know, the Muslim, Asian Islam, and mostly the Mughal, that in fact the Arabs are the ones who are hung up on the veil. The others are not. In 1334, the Moroccan traveler Ibn Battuta, the Muslim equivalent of Marco Polo, crossed Central Asia on his way to China and was amazed by the high level of respect to women paid by the Turks. Now he is speaking. I witnessed in these lands something remarkable, he writes. The high consideration accorded by the Turks to their women. Women enjoy among the Turks a higher position than men. As a good Moroccan, Ibn Battuta was especially astonished when he saw a prince salute a woman. I wouldn't say that the Moroccans are not, you know, they help me with the luggage, that's true. But, c'est vrai. But if we are in a queue to buy bread, he will try to pass me. But he will help me if I am having trouble with the luggage. The first time I saw the princess, she was riding in a chariot adorned with a sumptuous blue drape. Many chariots filled with women at her service followed hers. When she arrived in front of the princess' house, she stepped out of her chariot, and so did 30 women of her company. So you could imagine the movements of the floating silk dresses. The prince stood up and walked towards her, saluted her and invited her to take a seat beside her own. Now, this is really, you know, when the Mongol came, destroyed Baghdad and killed the last Arab caliph in 1254, something like that, 1250 something. They conquered Arab land and Muslims countries, but the fourth Khan, what's his name, the king, he became Muslim. That's the Mughal, that's how it started, the Mughal. But then they had one problem, because in the public life, women were part of the political scene. The Mughal had their wives with them and have their princesses and daughters right there. And that was the Arabs, they hide their wives. And that was one of the big clashes and changes in which every Islam, in fact, every culture creates its own Islam. This thing they are telling me about this Mr. Rumsfeld's terrorist Islam is a package. Someone has made that package to be consumed for good reasons, but it's just a package. Everyone is packaging his own Islam, but what is sure about Islam is that there is no such a thing as Islam. Each culture comes in with its own making. Alors, Ibn Battuta also repeats many times in his 750 pages Rihla, Voyage, dictated in 1355, that the women of the Turks do not veil, and you would often mistake the husband for the servant. All of these comments help us to regain the stereotype, so common today, that Islam is 100% misogynous. Ibn Battuta's remarks show that there was and is no such a thing as unified Muslim culture. If Arabs veiled women and kept them in marginal positions, Turks and Mongols didn't. I will stop here about this multiplicity. That's in the Quran. Multiplicity is positive, is in this verse, in this Quranic verse, which says, I cannot repeat because I am afraid to make a mistake, so I should find the text. ألسنتكم وألوانكم. I have to find it. خلق السماوات والأرض واختلاف مرسي واختلاف ألسنتكم وألوانكم. Among its miracles, I will just, for the ones who don't like to do research, is Surat Rum, verse, yes, it takes you a long time to find these things, 22. Surat Rum, the Romans. Among its miracles, he created the sky and the earth. And he created you from different languages and different colors. That's one of his miracles. So this is absolutely central to Islam and coming strong in the Sufi revivalism of the Jadal and of learning from foreigners and from the difference. This is key, and this satellite TV is giving it full bloom. Now can I talk about Bannur, this guy from the... I will make this circulate because I don't believe that it's good to show slides because people sleep. Maybe I should read about him because I do better reading what I write than talking. You see, I am from the north of Morocco. And for the north, I always thought the desert is terrible. I was always saying, my God, how can I live with so much dust? Well, it's only at last 7 years that I discovered the desert and discovered that it has also a strong culture. And that's where Sufism has really kept people going, because they have nothing to rely on except the belief that they are something fantastic, that a human being is something fantastic. So I was going from, to go to Zagora, you have to cross the High Atlas. And believe me, it's no joke to cross the High Atlas. And I get dizzy if I go up 500. And that was something like 2000 and up. And then we came onto, I was going to Zagora, and I stopped in this tiny village because I saw there was a market. And as sociologist, I know that if you want to learn about what's going on and the change, you just go in the market, souk, what we call souk, that is local market, and see what the people are buying. That's the best way. You see, I heard when I came that CNN and USA Today did a survey, a polling of Muslim opinion about September attack. Well, I was surprised that they did a polling. If polling means you call people on the telephone to get their number, isn't it? That's what it is. There is no other polling. You have to call them on the telephone. Just listen to this. In Morocco, never an Arab, Moroccan, will, if you call him on the telephone, he doesn't know you. That's number one. Intrusion. We are very private thing. And second, you are going to ask him about a very controversial political thing on the telephone, where we think all the police of the world is listening. Now, this is a joke. So, when I went back home, I stopped all the research techniques I learned at Brandeis. They didn't work. They didn't work. I had to create my own. And one of them is to study the souk. I just go to the souk and talk and sing and sit and eat and listen to what the people are saying. So I was in this souk. It's called Agdes. It's minus, I don't know, something smaller than Agdes. So I go to the souk and it stands, and you have everything. You come to buy everything for the week, from the meat, but also the books and the candle and everything. And I found something strange. Oh, I should be reading. No. I found something strange, and it was this mirror. This mirror is strange in the Arab world, why? In the Muslim world, because it is asymmetric. It's asymmetrical. It shouldn't be asymmetrical. Symmetry is what beauty is. So I stop in Mohammed Sbenno's tiny tent, where he displayed his modest goods on a white sheet spread on the floor, few feet away from the camel and sheep market in the noisy Zagora market on that memorable December 1999, because I saw something rare in a Muslim world, keen on symmetry. An asymmetrical mirror. When I asked him where he got it, he explained to me that it was done by his partner, a young Zagora artist who, like himself, recycles old pieces of wood to give them a second life. The mirror was made from old locks of traditional qsor, now this old kasbah, which was like fortress, but in fact the tribe was living in it. And they are just going into ruins because it's very difficult to maintain, and also because of migration. Moroccan South is losing its population. Qsor And he himself uses old wood used at tablets in Quranic schools to paint his own art. Since I didn't have enough money on me to buy the attractive mirror and the Quranic school tablet turned paintings, because I was buying this kind of jewelry, I asked Van Noor to give me an address or telephone number where I could contact him later. My big surprise, he invited me to his website, www.samler.ch/Van Noor. I couldn't believe that the street vendor in remote desert fringes has his website, while I, with an American PhD and and book published in 26 languages, still hesitate to have one. When I interviewed Van Noor at length that afternoon, I discovered that he calls himself autodidact, esami, self-taught, and would be labeled by local state bureaucrats or the United Nations and World Bank statisticians as illiterate, or anyway, not very educated, in spite of the fact that he taught himself not only painting by participating into local competitions, but also German and English. When I asked him to show me, of course, I was launching on this guy, but there were many like him, but I was just easy to keep to him. I told him, can I have a bio so I could interview him? He ran on the bicycle and brought me this bio in French. Now I told him, because this bio is better than the one I do with my students in the university. So I told him, listen, this you didn't do alone. He told me, no, I got a training from an NGO in this Zagora region who taught him the training. But of course, he doesn't have a diploma. These people are taking diploma. Now I told him, what about the languages? Where did you learn the language? So he told me, I got the books there. And there was another tent. There is the books. Now, when I went to the tent, there were the books financed by Saudi fundamentalist propaganda about fundamentalism. تحريم حلق اللحي. Why it is forbidden to shave your beard? الوجه وجوب ستر شروط الحجاب. شروط الحجاب, the conditions of the veil. I mean, why you should veil. But this was maybe one third, and two thirds were Almania min غير معلم, German without teacher. Al-Isbaniya mi ghayri muallim, Spanish without teacher, and so on. So, this is this revolution I'm talking about. After the 11th of September, I called him and asked him, do you have a satellite dish? Because we have this satellite dish analogic. It's something like 300 stations, but if you add just few dollars, you have numeric, and then you get 600. So I asked him, can you tell me what satellite dish does for you? So he writes, Al-Fada'iyya Sam'iyya Al-Basariyya. By the way, this guy, who didn't have much schooling, he speaks like Al Jazeera. Al Jazeera is the teacher. They speak very concise. Arabic, modern Arabic, very technical. So listen, I didn't know how to say the satellite dish. Al-Fada'iyya Sam'iyya Al-Basariyya Al-Parabol, and he adds the French one. He says, جعلت من هذه الوسائل الإعلامية التي جعلت العالم يعيش كأنه في قرية صغيرة. These instruments made the whole world live as if we are in a tiny village. عن طريق التلفاز تشاهد كل ما يجري في العالم وأنت في بيتك. Through this little television, you see everything happening in the world and you are sitting at home. وهذا يدخل سياسة الانفتاح عن الآخر. And this brings this capacity to open oneself and understand the other. And of course, about his case, he told me that, because I asked him, do you want to migrate? Because that's the problem, Morocco is being depleted with people, young people are running away. So he told me no. Now with the parable, he gets what he wants, which is he art and all these things he needs, which is to hear artists, to hear about what you mix, who's doing what, and so on. So I will stop here, and I think I am just aware that nothing happens just by chance. If Iqbal, this is the world he was dreaming of, in a way. It's the world where the little person could communicate with the world. And I will just stop here. Merci.
Thank you.
There is a microphone here at the front. If those who would like to ask questions would just walk up to the microphone, and you can line up behind several people at a time, not 20 people, but if those first person who would like to risk or take the chance of asking the first question would come up to the microphone. A lot of people standing up. Is anybody walking toward the microphone? Yes, yes, come ahead.
What is the quality of the Al Jazeera broadcasts?
What do you mean by quality? What?
Whatever you like.
Do you have just criteria so I could respond? Do you have some criteria in mind?
Yes, you gave the... You told us that the point was that they could have dialogue. The way they did it was through dialogue, which is a new idea. So how do you value the the program, you know?
I think that I value it. I look at this... by the way, after the attack, September attack, Al Jazeera, which was available on this $80 dish, parabole, you know, we call it satellite dish, we couldn't catch it anymore. I don't know why. So people had to rush and get the numeric. And I was one of them. I realized I was addicted to Al Jazeera, although I had this, 40 Arab stations, and all of them competing to please me. To please the Arab reader, the quality why I realized I like Al Jazeera, it's because they give me the two opinions. I hear Arafat and Sharon. They bring me that. And I hear the Taliban and Monsieur Rumsfeld. You know, I have them both. So that's what makes it, they respect me. They know they cannot just give me second-rate stuff. They try to get top. So I know that in 1 hour of Al Jazeera, I know a lot of information. That's maybe the why they have this.
Hi, Fateema. I hear in your talk a thread about this.
Can you say who you are? Just for us to know each other.
Frédéric Apfel-Marglin. I teach at Smith here, and I'm a very old friend of Fatima. What I hear is a thread about Sufism, that on that thread you have, thread pearls about just about everything you've talked. And am I, what I'm hearing, and I want to know whether I'm hearing you right, that you first said that there is an explosion of Sufism in Morocco. I know that's true too in Pakistan. That everybody, you said, everybody is into Sufism. And then in Pakistan, well, that's part of my question. And then you said, well, Morocco always was a Sufi country, but something new is happening. And I want you to, what I'm wondering is if this new thing that's happening, in spite of the fact that Sufism was always there, is that you are noticing an Al Jazeera with the use of Jadal and the use of dialogue, which is the master Sufi method, are you seeing this as a rising something among some new group in the Muslim world? And are you seeing this as a countervailing or as a more important movement than the Taliban and people and the Saudis?
About the Taliban and the Saudis, they never were important. They were important to the oil companies, you know, and the people who sell arms to the Arab world, and that's not you and me, you know. It's very little group. And in any case, extremism is never and was never something widespread. It was always, it only exists when you have despotism, of course. The fact that now America is afraid of terrorism, what they didn't know, we were always afraid of terrorism, but they didn't pay attention. I mean, that's the news. I am so amazed that they didn't, I mean, the Taliban were killing women and journalists and stifling life of people. But so, who was, I won't call them the majority. I mean, they were just terrorizing the people. Now, about Sufism. Sufism was really always part of the main culture. To answer your question, I will read, because even me, I didn't know that it was Sufism when I was growing up. This desire to open up and to understand the foreigner, that's for sure was always there. I mean, I don't know really. Many Moroccans who like to close themselves and so on. All Moroccans try to learn on their own foreign languages. I'm always amazed how many. In the north they speak Spanish, in the south they speak French, and now everywhere English because of the internet. Sufism, why it is strong, because it is coming out strong, it's because it gives dignity and insists that you that the value of a person is what it pursues. It's not the diploma, it's what preoccupies you. I mean, and you hear it all the time, that's what qimatul mar'i ma ya'ni, the value of a person is its preoccupation, its passions. I think, and that's my argument in this new book about cyber Islam, is why the World Bank and the IMF failed, because they were calling people poor, and poor was negative. in the Sufi, poor is positive. You try to be poor. Why? Because the less you consume, the better. Of course, this IMF doesn't want to hear about that. Ha, mais bien sûr. So this is why this thing is picking up. I just wanted about Sufism. It's coming out in the roots, in the people who have, like Bannour, in the fringes, where the state never did anything and where people are discovering their own strengths to introduce electricity and water and so on and create schools and teach themselves. Cyber cafes very soon will outnumber the mosques, by the way. Incroyable. But it's also the professionals. In Casablanca, this magazine, 35 years old kid, Benchemsi, as it is for the Casablanca professionals, they have this issue on Sufism. You know who goes there? They charter planes from Casablanca to go to Berken, where there is this Zawiya, sanctuary, with Hamza, this leader. But this Hamza is not interested in power. He was there for 30 years. He's interested in dialogue. And the people come there, doctors, lawyers, a lot of people who are just stressed, they come there to sing and meet with other people and cross class. You don't know with whom you are sitting. You might be sitting with your maid, actually. And that's the other thing about Sufism.
Yes.
Yeah, my name is Mahjoub Al-Ghalfi, and I live in Amherst. I would like to go back to the media issue. And of course, as an Arabic speaking person, I watch Al Jazeera, and I watch CNN and other channels here as well. And I would like your evaluation, your opinion about the media in this country when it comes to world problems, to other people in the world. I personally believe that we live, when it comes to world problems and people's lives elsewhere. We live in a monolithic, totalitarian media system. I would like you to expand on the idea of media in a third world country like Qatar, with Al Jazeera, outstanding two dialogue kind of setting. In this country, apart from Letterman and the other guy, like a dialogue or issue, it's really very, very totalitarian. Thank you.
You see, I am now at my age, I am getting to always now, I think, who is buying what? Who is selling what? When I hear ideas or see things. About this Jadal, you see, the it's financed by this Qatar prince. But what people don't know, there is many princes who are financing Arab satellites, because this is 300 million. Viewers, it's like all Europe speaks one language. But they don't recruit like Al Jazeera. Why? Because the others, like NBC, which was the Saudi, they cater the prince thing. I am an idiot. So he doesn't let the journalists do their job. So he lose. NBC lost. So there is many princes who are financing. What is happening is you can make in the Arab world, this is new. Before, you can make money from despotism. The army, the head of the state, his brother-in-law, and all that stuff. Now, you can make money from dialogue because the Arab person needs the dignity to be respected when you are giving him the news. So I think also maybe here, dialogue in the television is not money-making. But then you ask why. Je ne sais pas.
One more question, Alistair. You want to Alistair is one of the students visiting Hampshire from the University of Natal in Durban, South Africa. We give him the privilege of asking the last question, the last word, Alistair.
I'm sorry, but I feel that my question might have been answered originally, but I was just thinking that you consider the satellite television to be a great way of dialogue, and I was wondering if you consider yourself a champion for globalization, or do you view that it's just necessarily the new technologies such as the internet and the satellite which are needed in the Islamic world and perhaps the rest of the world for future dialogues to happen? I'm sorry, I was just wondering what your views are on globalization and whether you consider yourself for globalization or against it, or just for the dispersion of media and having a greater dialogue using satellite and internet.
Since I have you from South Africa, I have to ask you a question. Is what I described about the information, the technology revolution I explained happening in my past, is it happening in South Africa?
I wouldn't say it's happening in South Africa as much as in Morocco. My mum actually went to Zanzibar, which is also quite Islamic, and they're also having an internet revolution there, where internet cafes outnumber the mosques. South Africa is still quite backward with its technology, but we do have the capabilities for that type of that sort of explosion. And I, as a IT student, would like to actually extend that and get more South Africans connected, both television, meat, and the internet. So I wouldn't say it's quite on Morocco scale yet.
Yeah, I can tell you something about America. I am in North Africa. I have very few chances to talk with South Africans because we don't have money in my institute to bring South Africans or to bring foreign students. This is just one of the big assets America has, is to have this kind of diversity right here. This is really, Americans think we envy you. I don't envy much, but like about driving, I am so happy to live in a compacted city where I only have to do 20 minutes to go to my work, and I'll be really scared to be in this commuting thing. But this extraordinary international grouping I meet everywhere in America is really fabulous. Now I forgot the question. Globalization. Just for your information, I never felt I had a protecting boundary. They always brought goods which destroyed our industry. I have a whole theory. I don't think we have Arab states in modern times. They were not. They were agencies catering to foreign whatever, but not to me. So we always felt, in fact, the Gulf War. What did the Gulf War mean? It meant to the Arabs. Saddam Hussein is an Arab. He attacks other Arabs, the Kuwaiti. And then Monsieur Bush comes, boom, boom, boom. So what did we deduce? We deduce that neither Kuwait nor Iraq belongs to Arabs. We didn't have frontier to protect us. And that land is not ours. That was the message. So for us, globalization was always there. We never had frontier. We are not scared. We don't feel that we have a harem mentality. Maybe the men like to protect the woman so that she doesn't run away. But economically speaking, we are ready. We have nothing to lose. And we'd never had frontier. Et je crois que c'est ça l'Amérique. This closing the frontier is, in a globalization time, is not the best way to prepare oneself.
Thank you, and everybody give her, please, a nice hand. We are deeply grateful for a very special presentation. Thank you.